glasses on.
Yes, now we're glasses. Both ready to drop some knowledge bombs. All right, dude. So, yeah, again, thank you for coming. And, Nico, without further ado, why don't you get us started, man?
Oh, well, thanks. Thanks for the introduction, Mr. Miles. These are my backup glasses, so please don't make too much fun of them. So, yes, hi. My name is Nico, and I've made music for a show called Red versus Blue for quite some time now. And what I'd like to do is give you a little bit of some insights as to how it's worked historically, and how we've gotten to the point where we are now.
And can everybody hear us okay, by the way? Anybody in no trouble or anything?
Yes!
Thank you, audio guys.
Who here was here last year, just out of curiosity? Awesome. Okay.
You're going to learn a lot of some of the same stuff.
don't raise their expectations,
but there's other stuff, too. It's going to be good.
Okay, so taking you back about 11 years to 2003 when Red versus Blue started, the way that the music was made for the show was using either Pro Tools Free. Anybody know what that is? You know, no, of course not. None of you were born. And DEC. Anyone know what DEC is? No. Do you know what DEC is? Seriously?
No.
Yeah, exactly.
I have no idea what that
anyway,
is.
Anyway, so just to give you an idea, I'm going to show you what a folder for... I'm going to show you what a folder for episode 23 looked like. So this is so for those of you who don't know, I lived in Boston until 2009. Rooster Teeth has always been in Austin or nearby in Texas. So it's always been a remote endeavor. And this is what episode 23 music looked like, which was a few WAV files, not very big, right? And a README document that was either sent to Matt or Bernie. Now, back then, the way that the episodes worked is they were typically released, I believe, on Fridays to sponsors, and then people would comment on it, and then the general public episode was released on either Sundays or Mondays.
Yep.
One of those two
days. One of those days, yeah.
So, and this is what the episode notes look like. If anybody here works for Microsoft, I apologize. It's, let's see here. Yeah, it's... 2008. Thanks for making this stuff compatible, by the way. I will upgrade. This is a legal, perfectly bought copy. Anyway, this is what the notes look like. So these notes were usually sent to either Matt or Bernie, depending who was working on it. And the times where the little snippets were going to appear were on the notes. So it's pretty primitive, but it worked.
I always dug the transitions.
So there were about, you know, four or five different transitions that sounded, you know, I mean.
Oh, suddenly I'm in a nice place, surrounded by warm grass and really loud and annoying soldiers.
It's beautiful. The wah-wah sound always competed with the.
I like mine better.
I agree.
Did you actually record a new one for season 12?
Yeah.
No, or was that Matt's?
I dug through all the old stuff that you sent us. It's funny. In episode 8 of RvB12, we have the shot where Simmons is like, you know, there's nothing between us and the detention center. And I put that in, and we have a sound guy named who's awesome. Because normally with an episode of Red vs. Blue, what we used to do is every time a soldier takes a step, we got to put that shit in manually. But now that we have a sound guy, we just push that off on him. But he also he's a really talented guy and has worked on a lot of stuff. So we're like, hey man, if you can think of a sound effect that we haven't put in already that you want to sweeten the deal with, by all means go for it. And when I got episode 8 back, it gets to the part where someone's like, we're never gonna get over there. And then there's this like really cool sounding whoosh, and I'm like, yeah, you can't do that.
Yeah.
We need the dumb one.
That sounds like Matt. Like, so many times I tried to do things that sounded like sort of like cool and hi-fi, and like Matt or Bernie would be like, no.
Now give us the dumb one again. Thank you.
Dumb one.
I have that talk with him all the time. But yeah, give the one of just Matt or Bernie just going, whatever it was.
That one sounds pretty.
That's blues. That's the blues, right?
Yeah, it's blues. Yeah. One that way. Charge. Anyway, so that's how that worked, and it turned out that it was a very inefficient way to work, but it took us about 5 seasons to realize that. So the way it would work is they would send me the episode, and sometimes that was on a 28.8 modem. And ooh. So I'd, you know, download it, put the 6-7 chords, and then send it back. And so ultimately what started happening around season 5-ish is that, with the exception of certain episodes that the director, meaning Matt or Bernie, would want, or Gavin, later on, would want scored specifically, it would just be these type of things where, you know, it would be back and forth chords. And then after a while, we're like, hey, why don't I send them a bunch of chords and transition pieces, and then they can sort of pick the ones that they like, and we'll make the whole process a lot less painful. So that's what we started doing. And that worked pretty much up until, well, pretty much until you got involved, Mr. Luna.
Yeah. During the recollection and then the freelancer saga, with the high intensity action scenes that Monion provided, we needed some high intensity music from Jeff Williams, you know, crazy face melting guitar and all that stuff. When it came to Machinima and the Reds and Blues, I always felt that Trocadero, like the sound that they made, was RVB. So when I was told that I was going to be in charge of season 11, I was like, Nico, I need you, dude.
You used us a little bit in season 10 as well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Season 10 was like a lot of nights of me going through all the old archive stuff that you sent. I found Outpost Sunset from your second album, Ghosts That Linger. And I fell in love with that piece and immediately knew, I was like, this needs to go with the saddest scene ever. And it ended up going with the scene where Caboose walks away from church for the first time ever.
Right.
And it was one of those moments where I heard the song and I had the idea in my head. But at the time, we were only on like episode 2 of season 10. So I was like, oh, man, we're going to have to wait forever for this moment to happen. It was like that. And then with Far Away from Flying by Wire, I absolutely love that piece. And I was really, really excited to get to use it in episode 12 of season 10.
So this brings up two important considerations for Red versus Blue fans, which I'm assuming most of you are.
I would hope.
They've never heard of it. The first one is that Miles has done one thing, which he's tackled emotional content using just Machinima. And, you know, for those of you who are interested in making films or how films are made, you know, that's a pretty tall order because
it's really scary.
You know, I mean, you're talking about basically, if you exclude the animation, a video game puppet show. And so, you know, how do you care for the characters and get invested in with them? And, you know, you started doing that with season 10 with the scene with Carolina.
And I would not have had any confidence in that scene if it wasn't for this guy.
Has infinite sustain. In other words, if you hit a string and it's going dum, well, that energy is going to go away, right? That's the law of physics. You know, energy ends, right? And so what this electric guitar does, this Moog guitar, is that it spits this energy back. And so this is what it sounds like. It sounds a little bit like a keyboard. It's not a very good sounding guitar, to be honest with you, but it's a wonderful sounding thing. So this is essentially unprocessed. I have a little bit of EQ and reverb on it.
Very soothing.
Yeah, you haven't used that one yet. By soothing, he means boring.
No.
Typically, the way you can get that kind of sound with a guitar is if you're standing in front of a Marshall half stack and playing it at full volume. This is at a bedroom volume. So it's very pretty. You know, it reminds it might remind you of like a Mellotron or keyboards of that ilk. And that's what it sounds like when it's being pretty. When it's being a little bit darker.
I recognize this.
Now, this is completely analog, by the way. There's no digital processing that's going on. This is just a string that is just being, whose energy is being sustained by the guitar. And then you have the other strings that are trying to start vibrating, and the player has to mute them.
I love this drone. This is my favorite. This drone to me is Locus. I really love this bit, just because it's kind of like if you've seen The Dark Knight. The Joker kind of has this this constant, really high-pitched note that slowly, like, dips down into two other notes. And it just, it's like glass on a chalkboard. This, to me, is a just constant presence, this really heavy, just kind of uncomfortable feeling. Like, there's just someone in the room that just won't stop looking at you like they're about to snap your neck or they want to wear your skin or something like that. So whenever Locus is on screen, I love having this presence.
And I like to think of a glass on a chalkboard as my personal musical calling. So it fits pretty well. So now we can close the parenthesis, but that's an instrument that you're gonna that you've heard in instrument in season 11, even if you didn't know what it was called, and you hear it also in season 12. So going back to our little Right, so Miles gave me a call and he said that should be a bad guy theme, and I was like, "That's not meant to be a bad guy theme." And he's like, "Oh yes, it is." And so, you know, that turned into It turned into this, actually. Different key. All right, which is going to sound a little bit more. Which then turned into. That's with the Moog guitar supporting it. And the Moog guitar is a very nice supporting instrument. It's very good at creating a soundscape.
The kind of idea behind this theme for Locus was he typically doesn't say much. Kind of like the meta, he lets his actions talk for him. And this song, I described it, and several other samples that you sent me early on, as kind of like a snake in the grass. If a snake's in the grass, it's fine. It's something incredibly dangerous, but unless provoked or nearby, it's not really going to fuck with you. But knowing that it's there is really, really scary. And what I loved about the little melody was that it's not necessarily like... This is going to lead me into another fun fact right after this. It's not necessarily like... a proper like 4/4 time, like it doesn't feel like it's kind of off a little bit. There's no like super precise rhythm to it. It's bum 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 bum, but like it's kind of just jumping all over the place. It's unsettled. It's a little crazy, kind of like the character. Not to derail you or anything, but no, this is one thing I love about Nico. So I don't know music. I can't read music. I don't know music terminology. He had to reteach me what a bar was a few weeks ago. Like I don't know all the vocabulary musician should know.
Any person who's been on the website for more than 5 years can tell you what a bar is.
Shut up. Okay. So. That was good. That was good.
You like that?
I did. That was good.
It was a little forced, I thought.
No, it was all right. No, I dug it. No, it's good.
French.
Anyways, my favorite thing about Nico is, I can't say, you know, play. I don't even know the words right now. I can't explain it. I can't tell him anything useful. Essentially, I have to use things like, I want it to be eerie, make it a snake in the grass. I want to do this. And it's a lot of me on the phone going like, no. It's all like, banana, doo-doo-ba-doo-doo-dee-da. That was the episode 8, the huge cliffhanger scene when the sewage pipe breaks and everybody's running. Like the night before that episode premiere, it was me on the phone going like, and then it goes da 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 da, and then we go da 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 da, boom, and we end it right there. And Caboose says something dumb, and we cut to black. And he was like, all right, it's me walking around the room, just like all like we have at the new place we have conference rooms, but they don't have ceilings. So all the animators, there's just a big window, and all the animators are working on Ruby, and they look to the left, and they just see me pacing back and forth, going, and it was just like, I look out, and I'm like, what are you doing? Get back to work.
This is sort of like what we look like when we're working together. So actually, Miles came up to Washington State where we live, and
it's just as rainy as they say it is.
So so of course Miles is selling himself short. He is one of the most musical people that I know. He just doesn't know it. He's like one of those superhero that doesn't know he has superpowers. In fact, at one point I tested him on the phone. I was like, dude, I think you have perfect pitch, and he's like, no, I don't. And I'm like, sing me a B, and he's like, what the fuck is a B? And but yet, you know, we recorded like this tiny little Ruby thing Can I tell them about that? No.
No, no, don't tell them about it. But we did a guitar thing for
RvB. But we did a little, like a tiny, like literally, it's not important. But
I think it's pretty important to the joke. But you know, we'll see.
Well, whatever. And it involved singing, Miles singing, and he's like, "Can you add just a little bit of guitar to this?" And I was like, "Sure." You know, so we pulled it up on the project, and it was in perfect tune. Like I thought I was gonna have to retune my guitar because you know most people don't have perfect pitch, and so. Yes, one day Miles will realize that he has perfect pitch. You do.
Until then, I'm just mild-mannered rider, Miles.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, he came to Washington, and we worked.
Superman.
We started Miles. Working on, and so that's the other great thing about Miles is that he's got, you know, like as any one of you have like a career freelancing or working as a contract worker. Raise your hands. What really? That's come on. All right, that's cool. So you know that regardless of what you know field you're in. Having a client who knows what he or she wants is like the greatest blessing in the world. The worst thing you want is a client who's like, well, I don't know, something that's like kind of green, right? That's like,
I had to work on a commercial one time and the client's like, oh, you know, just something that pops.
That pops.
Oh, that pops. Sings. Oh, I'm sorry. Of course, pops. What the fuck does that mean?
Exactly. And so,
you're talking about armor. It was, I'm not going to go down this road.
So for season 12, we were working on a new theme and you know, Miles, actually, you called me up like a bunch of months ago and you were like, hey, you know, 3 months from now when we start working on a new theme, how about it goes? And you started some stuff.
So contact was the thing that you came up with for season 11, which I love, by the way. We
loves you back.
We wanted to reboot, but you know, we didn't want to try and top season 10. We wanted to do something different, go back to Blood Gulch. And Blood Gulch starts with a bop. Everybody knows the theme. And I was really excited about trying to do a new theme at the beginning of every episode to kind of say this is a new chapter in RvB. And you sent me
season, not episode.
Yeah.
I'm not writing your new
opening
for every episode.
So yeah, you sent me contact and I loved it. We played around with it and you got the and all that stuff. That was beautiful. With season 12, season 11 was very much comedy up until the end when we have that dramatic change in tone when Locust shows up and fucks everything. With 12, it was going to be, you know, it's kind of, we have Tucker going through an interesting story arc and things are starting to mature a little bit more with the Blood Gulch crew. And I wanted to do that with Contact. I didn't want to do a completely new theme, although you tried to sell me on a few.
Oh, yeah.
I was really adamant about doing what I refer to as an evolution of Contact, which we ended up calling Relay, which is what you now hear at the beginning of every episode. And it was really funny because we talked about it while we were in Washington. And I go, Nico, how much do you know about Pokemon? And he looked at me like I was a fucking idiot. And I was like, okay, well, in Pokemon, you have a Charmander, right? It's a cute lizard with fire on its tail. But eventually Charmander evolves into Charmeleon, which is kind of a pissed off looking lizard with fire on its tail and a little like bone sticking out of its head. But then Charmeleon evolves into Charizard, which is this badass looking dragon lizard with fire on its tail. And he's just a total asshole. But you can still see where they all came from. And that's what I wanted to do with season 12. I wanted there to be just enough of Contact left, but then I wanted it to change into something a little more mature. And then that's how we got Relay.
Yeah, this is us working on that.
Oh, shit. I forgot we.
Is there volume?
Do we have audio for this?
Yeah,
oh,
we
Jesus
do.
Christ, I hope not.
No, I think it's muted.
Hang wah, on. Wah.
Doo-doo.
We'll reenact
yeah,
it.
Look, that looks like audio. Hang on. You think I knew how to use the software? It's that I don't really have.
Where's the achievement hunter technical difficulty thing?
I actually have a Razer mouse that I use.
Oh, here we go. Oh, fuck. I don't know what I'm doing. It's going to be a
oh, holy shit, no way. Lillian.
This is when we realized that the Reconstruction Big Prize theme is in Relay.
That's kind of cool.
Play that again.
A lot of that.
There was a lot of Nico going, fuck, fuck, shit, fuck.
This is what it ended up sort of sounding. Yes, I do. I think we have the slow version too.
I love the slow version. Do you have the other version of the string one too, by any chance?
Oh.
If not, that's fine.
Yeah, I do.
Okay, so hold on real quick. So we did that. And this is what I love about Nico is I also draw a lot of inspiration from, like everybody, you watch TV, you watch movies, you get inspired by the media that you consume. And a lot of times, sometimes a song that I hear, whether it be off the radio or something that Nico just plays, like with the Locust theme, inspires an idea in my head. And after I heard that slowed down version of Relay, it gave me an idea for a scene that's going to happen at some point in time this season that I will talk about. Pause real quick. So I heard it just on guitar. Oh, it's okay. We obviously don't have access to a huge orchestra or anything like that. But we do have, isn't it the same stuff that Marty O'Donnell used for the Halo 1?
Yeah, it's a synth called the JD990, and it's made by Roland in the 1990s, oddly enough. And he used it for Myth. Any Bungie fans who played Myth here? Yeah, raise your hand.
Nice.
Come on.
Right on.
Awesome. Greatest multiplayer game ever made. And so when he started making music for Halo, he used he worked with the JD990 as well as some real live musicians. So it became sort of a hybrid thing. But yeah, it's
so
got that feel.
What's interesting about this particular instrument is it can't necessarily, you know, recreate the sound of an actual orchestra. It sounds, you know, a little canned if you try and make it do what it shouldn't be able to do, which is, like I said, replicate an orchestra. But you can use it as support, something really light. We used it in the episode 8. We had the strings. Those strings were not the main focus. The main focus was the drums and the guitar and stuff near the end. But again, if you use it as support, you don't really notice that it's a fake orchestra. And that was the idea after I heard the slowdown relay. I wanted something to help a moment that'll come down the road, and I just want it to be very subtle and very soft and in the background.
You told me to warn you about not divulging spoilers.
Yeah, I won't. Don't worry. I just wanted a really nice piece of music, which normally you don't have an RVB. Normally it's like crazy and zany and stuff. But yeah, I think the strings really help make this sound much sweeter.
Can we play?
No, it's okay. I was gonna say just for comparison, play the old one, and then play the one with the strings.
You play space bar.
Can you play just guitar real quick?
Just guitar
real quick.
I don't think I can.
Oh, shut up. You can do it, I believe. I love it. It's beautiful. Now let's add the strings. Just very slight bit of help from these guys. And suddenly it feels so much more emotional. And I loved that. That was just kind of two instruments hanging out and being buds. I don't know if that taught you anything. I just thought it was cool.
Okay.
I'm the worst thing that could happen to the educational portion of this panel.
That's totally not true. You said it perfectly. It's not a great lead instrument, but it's a wonderful support instrument.
Okay, let's see. 1:30. We're doing great, man.
Yeah,
right
are.
On time.
So what do you got for us next?
So that was part one of the panel. Part two is an analysis of The Brothers Karamazov by Fyodor Dostoevsky.
We will be taking a slight intermission at part 37.
Хорошо, молодец.
Да?
I don't know what you said, but it sounded cool.
Пожалуйста.
До свидания, comrade.
Yeah, до свидания.
Okay, that little ball right there, not good.
It's our worst fucking enemy.
Nah.
It looks pretty, but it's a dick.
It really is. It should be a little dick going like...
No, it should just be this. Just replace the cursor with that, and I get the point, Mac.
Like a little, like, you know.
It's just slow, like...
I was saying fucking thing.
I was gonna say it's like that scene in The Breakfast Club, you know, where he says like, you know, can you hear this? Do you need me to turn it up? But I like the crank better. The crank's much better. Okay, we're gonna try relaunching. And if that doesn't work, we're gonna try restarting. And if that doesn't work,
I'm just gonna acapella it. It'll be
good. Initializing. Where's the cancel button? Oh, I do have a mouse. Part two. Yay. Hey, let's check it out. Please work. Come on. Yeah, so good. That's good. You're not going to hear any of that shit. That's muted. Sorry. That was just part of the project. This project was actually part of... This project was part of episode 18 from last season. And that was certainly the most ambitious music project that I've been involved in as far as Red versus Blue goes. And I'm told there's...
You nailed it, dude.
Oh, thanks, man. Anyway, so, right. So what we're going to do here is we're just going to look at a couple of moments and we're going to have a little bit of fun. We're going to look at the same moment with different pieces of music and see what that does to it, if anything. Might be nothing at all. Let's...
Sorry. It's my Simpsons reference.
No, it's good. It's good. Let's see here. Let's just have a look at the moment by itself without... anything getting in its way, assuming we don't crash.
Spoiler alert, by the way, if you haven't watched season 11.
Yeah, if you haven't watched season 11, well...
Shit's about to get real.
No. You can't.
Wash! Oh, no! Is he okay? Stop it!
En serio, acabo de recibir este maldito cuerpo.
You bastard, stay away from my men! If anybody's gonna kill him, it's gonna be me! Sarge? He's coming!
Sorry.
Get to the gate! We gotta go! We'll light him out! Watch him strangle! Quick, someone help me carry Sarge! No! Wait!
I love that. Wait!
There's no time! Get out of here! Hey, Caboose, come on! What are you doing? Where's Wash? He's still at the base! What? Suck!
Okay, so, I love the part where he says, wait, as he's being killed, because it reminds me of the scene from Saving Private Ryan. Do you know the one I'm talking about with the American soldier and the German guy?
That kills me. You know what that kills me every time? Is the dude that gets stabbed looks kind of like one of my uncles, and it's just like, Steve, no!
That part terrifies me.
That was our sales team at the time, Chris and Alan. We got the footage, and I wanted to try and get something to go along with those moments, and they did a great job.
That's. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to now play you the same scene with the music that went with it, and I'm going to play it with some different, very, very different music. And what I want y'all to do, we're going to keep the commentary to a minimum, is just to think what the different pieces of music, how they affect your interpretation of the content of the scene. Now, I did not edit any of the additional music, meaning that the songs sort of like are supposed to sort of fare on their own. And after that, we'll bring it up to some questions.
All right, I hope one of the songs is New Brush.
I tried that actually. It's kind of cool.
I don't know how many people in this audience know that song.
A couple. All right, here we go. I hope this works. I don't really know what I'm doing.
Thank you.
Yeah.
why I asked about this one.
Fuck you! Yeah!
All makes sense now.
All right. Well, I have described RvB as punk rock before.
Last one is something you might be familiar with if you watch Reconstructions.
Shit!
Oh,
that was real.
Oh no!
You okay?
Thank you very much, and now we'll take some questions.
Yeah. Oh, that song, man, always gets you.
The former director brought in Ray Lander.
Oh, I know.
Dr. Well, Lennon
John, Jones. The actor, is ridiculous.
God. John Reed's fucking got a cool voice, man. He somehow managed to take the word fire and make it a two-syllable word.
Fire. Love him.
When I first heard him, he sounded like he smoked about 5 packs a day. And when I met him, I noticed he did actually smoke.
Yeah, I'm glad you made that joke. It's like, oh, you're not far off, buddy.
Okay.
Hello.
First, I had a question about First Wave, which is the lovely song we all just listened to.
Sure.
I noticed that at the end of season 6 on the DVD, that track is actually about 2 minutes longer than the one on the album. Is there a way to get the extended version of that?
There will be next week.
Okay, excellent. Which totally leads into my second question. When are we going to be able to purchase more music from you?
by the end of season 12.
Hoping to.
The plan is to have the soundtrack released to coincide with the end of the season.
Will it be a 11 and 12 combined soundtrack?
Yes. I think so. And absolutely. Possibly some other bonus stuff.
Yes.
Awesome. I look forward to it.
Fingers crossed we get that
done. I'll post the extended version of First Wave. Hi.
Hi. I noticed that you make themes for certain things, like multiple things. Like you do characters, and then you also do locations and also seasons.
Yeah.
A lot of places will exclusively do for characters, relationships, or places. How do you decide what you like to do and what you do? Like, is there one you prefer making them for characters or seasons or something?
That's a good question. originally, it's funny, one of the themes that you hear in like the original version of that episode is the New Republic theme, that ba na 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 ba da do da 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 da. Anyways, originally that was going to be Felix's theme, but then as we started to explore Felix more as a character, and you know, he's kind of gives off that damaged goods sort of vibe, we wanted to change it up and give him something a little darker, but I still really enjoyed that theme, and it was kind of just like Lone Ranger, the odds are stacked against them, but there's still some hope as they ride off into the sunset kind of feel. And I really dug that. It felt at home with the underdogs of the New Republic. I don't know how certain characters get themes and certain ones don't. I really pay a lot of attention to villains, just because I love villains. Like that's what I love about Batman. Batman is pretty cool, but his villains are incredible. And I think it's really important for a good villain to have something to accompany them into battle.
That's one of the prices that we pay by working remotely, but also it's a double-edged sword. We benefit from it, is that, you know, I'll send themes out, and to give you, to let you in on a little secret, the song Big Prize, that was meant to be a Griffball theme song originally, and it slowly made its way into Reconstruction and became, you know, much more synonymous with Reconstruction. So, you know, it's somewhat of a collaborative thing where I'll say, hey, how about this? And then, you know, you'll say, that sounds great, but that's the babysitter's theme song, not the big bad villain. And so.
And then sometimes it just happens on accident. Like episode 16 of season 11 is like what I refer to as the plot dump episode. It's literally called FAQ. That is the name of the episode. Because all it is Felix explaining the plot of what the next two, like the next season's going to be. So like we've had a few episodes like that this season that I always like bite my nails over because it's like, shh, is this gonna be really fucking boring or what? And a lot of times that's when I lean on Nico really hard, saying like, hey, this is just a character talking at the audience because I'm sometimes a shitty writer, and he's gonna need some help. So in episode 16 we have a song that just starts off. Is it keys? It's is it just synth at the beginning? I'm losing my voice,
which
so I can't
which
do
episode?
It. Episode 16.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I'm talking about chorus.
Oh, yeah, yeah, sure. Yeah. No, so chorus, there's a company called Electro Harmonics. They make these pedals, including a chorus pedal, and that's, it's actually the baritone guitar getting processed through them.
By the way, is there anybody in here immediately after us? Like, are we going to be in big trouble if we go a little bit late? Fucking sweet. All right.
Who's got rum?
So, with that, hey,
ladies
what's
and
up,
gentlemen,
dude? Matt Hollum, voice of Doc. He just expressed his love to me, but also, check it out. I feel like you should be the one.
This is how I express my love to Miles.
Hey, wait, hold on, another wheel here.
I really think
Mixer, it didn't happen.
Oh, no.
Oh.
I honestly feel like you should be the one to say it. I really think you should.
I just want to let you guys know, because we're all in here, they just made an announcement on the main stage that while we've been in here, that Laser Team crossed the threshold to become the most funded film of all time on Indiegogo. Yeah!
That is incredible. That's super cool.
So, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt the panel. I just thought everybody would want to know that. And just want to say thank you to everybody. And also thank you to these guys because, you know, Nico's been doing amazing stuff for 12 years now with us, and we wouldn't be crossing thresholds like that without everybody's hard work.
So I've been riding your coattails for 11 years.
Thanks, Matt. That's fucking awesome.
Thank you, Matt.
Holy cow, man. That's cool. Shit. Well, now back to our dumb music panel. So what I was getting at with sometimes themes happen on accident. The song which we now refer to as chorus is the song that we played throughout episode 16. It's just like keys, and then every now and then towards the end of the episode you get boom 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 boom, and then we get a kick drum, to, and then you have the drums from the Reconstructions that, and essentially it wasn't a lot to go off of. It was just a few instruments. But we use them.
Story of your life.
We use them in a way where we introduce them each very, very gradually. So first, when and there's a few guitar strums. Some blah, blah, blah. When Felix first starts talking and he has a few lines, every time he speaks, we just get a blah. Who's this new guy? He's kind of interesting. Kind of mysterious. Then we start to get into the lore of chorus and the Civil War. And that's where we get the, it's almost like a choir of people. How symbolic is the planet's called chorus? That totally didn't happen on accident. And then when things start to get heavy and he's talking about how we're going to be attacked, there's nothing we can do. That's when we bring in the, Boom, boom, shit's about to get real. Prepared. Clench your buttholes. This is awful. And that's what carries us through a lot of it. And then finally, when they all turn to Wash and go, what do we do? That's when it's time for him to make the decision. We get the boom, kah, boom, kah, I'm on board. Let's fucking do this. And it was really, really fun. And then we just decided, like, well, seeing as that whole conversation is kind of about chorus, let's make that the chorus theme song. And we use it again, spoiler alert, if you caught the RvB panel in episode 9, when we have a similar conversation.
That's one of the things that's really evolved in terms of, you know, me working with Rooster Teeth, is that it's almost become even more than a collaboration. Miles has almost been more of an arranger, and that's happened with Bernie. It's happened with Matt when I came during the Reconstruction era, where I'll play like three notes because I'm a three note guy. Like, I mean, you know, people who study music, you know, you'll hear idée fixe or ostinato is another fancy word for it, but that basically means playing the same shit over and over again and just changing, you know, the supporting chords. And, you know, Miles will say, well, why don't you do this? Take out the drums. And he really gets my minimalist approach. My minimalist approach is because I'm not super smart, but that's how it ends up happening. And so there's a lot of arranging that goes on when we work together.
Okay, I think the last comment I have on that question real quick is...
Jesus Christ.
Sorry. Is one thing that I always thought was interesting was you guys ever play Super Mario Brothers? Yeah. So everybody knows the theme song. Ba da ba ba da ba ba. That's World 1. What's World 1 2? Bum bum bum. Bum bum. Everybody knows it. So those songs are essentially just like really catchy melodies that are repeated over and over again because there's not a lot of space on the game at the time. So you don't have much to work with, so you got to make it catchy and burn it into your brain. I think that's cool. I really, really like and latch onto melodies for things. I think, you know, it's cool when you hear a song and you immediately think of a character or a place. It's, you know, it's like if you heard a song from when you were in middle school, it takes you back to all the good old days of being picked on, at least for me. So I don't know. I think I try and get like, I want you to remember the things that we do. So I think that's why I try and focus on melodies and themes and stuff. So yeah, great question. Thank you.
Thank you.
And thanks for standing there forever. Sorry about that.
Hi, Nico.
Hi.
I got to ask you something on the RT side. I picked up on that you really like to play with themes like the radio thing. I asked you if in Heart with Wings you go near your ear, can you hear the short long range transmission from the shortwave radio gear that's busted. And I was like, Chorus had a radio in it, and I asked you if it was connected, and you said no, but I'm wondering now if there are like other themes that you like to put in that people don't pick up on regularly, like the French or the numbers or
hundreds of them.
No? I'm sorry.
And one day you will all know. some stuff is deliberate and some stuff is a little bit hidden, and there are little, you know, hidden messages. Some of the stuff is what you make of it. And I would be doing all of us a disservice if I, you know, laid out my carefully planned plan. Thing.
Step one of plan, make music. Step two, hope people enjoy music.
but I mean, I love radio, and you know, I mean, if you go into websites where ham radio fanatics and see sort of like where they're coming from, listening to people halfway across the world talking about either, you know, my truck's broken or, you know, I'm just sitting in my basement, it's fascinating to me. And you know, there are correlations between both the isolation and the connection that you feel when you're listening to other people as a radio enthusiast, as if you're, you know, part of a terrible, terribly incompetent red or blue army in the middle of space. So there are some parallels there, but that's just, it's just a hobby of mine. It's something I really like.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Good question.
What's up, man?
Hi.
Hey.
As someone who's looking to potentially pursue a career in doing music for games, I've also kind of toyed with the idea of doing music for film. How does someone like me wind up getting into a position kind of where y'all are at?
Sure.
Kind of right now.
I'm the absolute worst person to ask because I'm the classic example of, you know, I'm a hack. I never really studied music formally. I studied it a little bit in college, but just as classes. Get lucky, and if you can't get lucky, make the luck happen. Just send out emails. I mean, with Red versus Blue is just a lucky email. I'm like the classic example of just, you know, the right no talent person at the right time. Wrong or whatever.
How does it go in English?
The right place at the right time?
What exactement?
I don't speak your made up language, dude.
Boom among.
Soy Miles, me amo es. I'm
sorry. I think it's great. I think you should do it. I would encourage you, if you can, to like study it, you know, study music formally, especially composition, because mm-hmm. that's where I find myself really struggling, is not having, I mean, it's like, you know, if you're setting up like a like drywall in a room, you know, you can do it yourself, but it's going to take you five times as long as if you just hung out with your contractor and he said, this is what you use, this is the kind of brand that you use, you know, that's the kind of tape that you use. But there's no doubt that in 2014, it's a tough career, and musicians suffer from the fact that everyone pretty much thinks that pirating you is an okay thing because it's not considered a crime. At the same time, your fans will support you more than fans traditionally support music artists. So you're almost going back to this 300-year-old notion that artists are supported by like really wealthy people. I mean, that's how it worked in France, right? It's, you know, if you were a painter, you didn't get paid shit, but the king or the king's whatever noble people would give you money to support yourself because that was part of the deal. The aristocracy would help you out. And that part has almost become a democracy. Like, look, if you look at the Indiegogo, you know, thing that's going on with Rooster Teeth, I mean, you know, it's not five billionaires that are supporting this project. It's tens of thousands of people giving $5 each, $10 each. So, you know, there's hope, and it's an evolving situation. I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah. So we're at time right now, and if anybody has other panels that they want to go to, by all means, GTFO. You guys can get out. But I think we might go for like maybe like 5-10 more minutes to answer a few more questions.
Okay.
If you guys got to go, thank you for coming, and we love you. So, yeah, enjoy the rest of RTX.
Okay, we have to be quicker about answering questions.
Yeah, we'll be quicker. We'll be quicker.
Okay, here we go.
All right.
All right, then I guess I'll shorten my questions. First, for Laser Team, will you help with the score, Nico?
I hope so.
Good.
Thank you.
And also... Oh. concerning your music.
Because I love disco.
Concerning your music and also all the music of RvB, what is your opinion on remixes? Because that's what I do. I'm a techno guy, and therefore I like doing remixes.
Are you on the website?
Kind of. I'm linked with my Facebook account. So, yeah, kind of.
Well, message me.
All right,
so
sure.
I'm my name is Nico on the website. Message me and show me links to your work. And if I like your stuff, I'll send you stems.
Okay,
we'll work
sure.
something out.
Also, can I get a retake of my picture of Miles at the RTAA panel? I screwed it up.
Can we do it right after this?
Yeah, sure.
Cool. Okay, hope you don't mind hanging out for like 5 or 10 more minutes.
Sweet.
Thank you.
Yes, I was wondering, Miles.
Yeah.
What is your favorite song that Nico has written?
Colors. Mm-hmm. Colors is hands down my favorite song, dude. If I had all the time in the world and way more talent, I would love to do, like, this sounds really dumb, but, like, you know, like, animes have really long, cool, almost music video-esque openings?
Because
I would love to do that to the song Colors. Like, I got images of, like, you know, Sarge and the gang, like, chasing after the warthog, and then a pelican comes up behind it, and then it's, like, people, it's crazy, and they see Sigma coming out of the dark, and I love that song. I think it's a gorgeous song, and it just makes me think of the gang in Blood Gulch. I love that song. Close second place is Far Away, because it's awesome and powerful. Good question. Thanks, man. It's kind of short.
Okay, I was watching the Red versus Blue commentary, and I think it was you that said that you got the tempo for Freckles' theme by the speed of a crouched mantis.
Yep. So Manticore Blues. Yeah, you want
to talk about that? We literally sat in front of an Xbox. We tried to do it on YouTube, but because of like stutter or something that was going
shitty
on,
internet at the office,
just,
ironically.
Yeah, it was just not good. So we ended up firing up an Xbox and you know, literally like we made a Manticore walk. And then there's a website. This is an amazingly important website for musicians. It's this website, and you just go
tap, 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 tap. That's awesome.
And it tells you what the BPM is, right? I use this all the time. So we figured out what the average BPM was for Mantis Walking. We figured it was 90 something.
Pum-ba-da-da, 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 pum-ba-da-da-da-dum.
Yeah, it was really important. I really had the idea was just like the foot, all those close shots, and then the like, oh, what the fuck kind of shot. So having it timed to the footsteps was really, really, really important to me. Just to get that, like, because it needed to be intimidating but also silly. That was like the main like drive behind Freckles, was like, you're scared that he's gonna kill you, but it's also hilarious that this is someone's pet.
That smile's whistling at the very end of the tune, by the way. Yep.
I was wondering if you did anything else like from the game in the music.
That's a good question. I don't.
How do you mean from the game?
Like if we based anything else off of something like that.
Well, I mean, everything we've ever done is based from the game. Right?
I can't think of another instance kind of like,
but the, not
what
directly,
we had with Manicore Blues. The only other kind of like referential thing that we ever did or I ever thought of was that seemed to work out was First Wave is the way that we end episode 6 with the big speech and reveal and stuff there. The song that we use at the end of season 11 is Third Wave. I just thought it was cool that we were going to end another season with like the third part in this like three-part musical thing that Nico did. So one first and foremost, the song seemed to fit with the tone of the moment. But then like that was my own little like happy joy. I was like, oh, it's almost like Reconstruction, but not as cool.
one of the challenges is that, you know, we're doing something that uses Halo characters, but it's you know, it's not Halo. So like musically, for instance, like I love Marty O'Donnell. I love him. I love every note the man's ever written, I think. But I had to step away from him as far as I could to, you know, create sort of its own identity to Red versus Blue. Okay.
We can only do like let's do like two more questions.
Okay.
Sorry, everybody in the back. I'm really sorry.
Thank you. Sorry for waiting.
Hi.
Hi. Hey, how you doing?
My question is, you were talking about earlier that you didn't intend that theme to be a bad guy theme, but Miles said, like, can we make this a bad guy theme?
Yes.
Have you ever made
I didn't intend it to be a theme. It was just a chord.
Have you ever made any pieces for, like, specific characters or specific things in the show? Like what?
Well, Tex, I mean, is probably the most recognizable one. I've made themes that never went anywhere. Bernie played them once at an RVBTO, did one for Lopez, which is sort of like this nerdy, computery, Spanishy type thing. I made one for Church.
Tucker.
Oh yeah. What was that? What was Tucker's one? It was, Bernie played it. I'd have to find it. I don't know where it is, but, yes, the answer is yes. I've made them. Some of them evolve, some of them anywhere, some of them turn into something else. I mean, the characters that I really want to write for are Sarge, Gus, and Jeff's character Griff, but I haven't hit it yet. Working on it.
Cool. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. Last one.
Last question.
All right. And I was wondering, like, in season 8, 9, and 10, there were lots of really cool songs with some amazing vocals. I was wondering if you're going to bring back any more songs with vocals.
I personally dislike songs with vocals in like movies and television, unless it's like for a really specific, like unless like the moment seems to call for vocals. Generally, I feel like they're distracting. I think they're great for, you know, like end credit song and stuff like that. It all really depends on the moment. Personally, I don't think so. I don't really see doing stuff like that for anything in 12 and possible future. But that's also just my opinion. Some people really love it. But I just kind of like the instruments. I feel like the instruments do enough. Kind of like how we use the synth just to support some of the bigger instruments in the song. I feel like music is there to support the dialogue and the moments that you see on screen. So, yeah, good question.
As you're writing, like, do you think of the music as you're writing? Like, you write a line, then you think, okay, this is the mood of the moment. This is the, like, I have something in my head that I'm going to create later.
More often than not, I'll hear the music first and then think, like, oh, this will go great with like a moment that I had in my mind or something like that. There are some times though where, yeah, so again, to go back to episode 8 of season 12, I don't know why I just had that like dun 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 in my head while I was writing it. Felt like urgent, like we gotta go somewhere now, things are happening. So sometimes, yeah, and Nico always does a really good job of helping put that together.
It's a really good point that you make though about lyrics, because if you listen to like the intro song to Ruby, it's like, I mean, it couldn't be more appropriate, and it's so perfect, and it does have singing, you know, and then that brings you into a whole different plane of thinking when you listen to anime music. I mean, personally, noir is probably my favorite anime, and it's got music that's sung in Japanese, which I can't understand, and that brings up like a whole new sort of like, you know, how does that music work with you? But if you go back to what we just did, right, when I played that song by this wonderful band Butt Trumpet, the one where, you know, the
everybody was cursing.
Going, fuck you. It's distracting. It conflicts over what the scene is trying to do. It's funny, and I did it, you know, to sort of show you all what how that can work. But I agree with you, Miles, that lyrics can, unless they're, you have to be really careful, they need to be judiciously placed to create sort of a seamless message between what the director want, what the animator want, what, you know, what the writers want, and so that you as an audience, you don't get confused. And that's why most movie music is instrumental.
I will say,
I still work with lyrics.
I just realized there actually has been one moment in me working on RVB where I did specifically want a lyrics from one of Nico's songs, and that was for the season 12 teaser trailer. The song is Half-Life off the first album. And it's awesome. It's a very gradual song with a really slow build, and then the guitars just slap you in the face at the very end. They just blow out your speakers and just hits you with so much like anger and ferocity and all this emotion and stuff. And then after the guitars go higher, drums, everything, it's all there, and then it all goes out, and you just hear. And I wonder where you are. I don't know why I sang it. You're right there.
I want to see if it's in key.
But
I want to see.
My voice is cracky.
And I wonder where you are. This is just a test.
All right.
It may be off, but who knows? I just want to try it.
I'm lost inside.
Do you see?
Oh, hell. You got perfect pitch, bro.
So, I wanted. There's two moments in that song. If you look at the trailer, right before we cut to the action in that trailer, there's the chorus. It's a half-life. It's a half-life.
Now you're off.
It's a half-life. It's a half-life. Ba-da-da-da. So he gave me two versions. We have the original version of the song with all the lyrics, and then a version of the song that's only the instruments. Throughout most of the trailer, it's just the instrumental version because we have Vanessa Kimball speaking, and that would be too. Everybody would be talking at one time. It's annoying. But with that last moment, that build up to right before the action, I played it and I was like, it's fucking missing something. What is it missing? And it was just missing the harmonized vocals of the. And then so we put that in just because at that point, to me, the vocalists weren't doing like lyrics and stuff. That was like they became an instrument with that, with the current word they were singing. But then the very end, I wanted to keep, and I wonder where you are, because I felt like it fit in with the theme of the season. They're lost, they're in space, and they're separated, and they're isolated, and they just want to get back together. And that was one time where I thought the lyrics are really going to help this for the people that are insane and look way too into it like me.
And what about, like, say, songs that aren't in the show, but you have them in the album and they're about the show? Like, say, Come On Carolina from the season 10 album.
What about them? Like, I'm sorry, what was that?
Song? Do you want have any thoughts of like wanting to add them?
Typically, like, no. Blues, no, typically like that. Not that, just because I feel like, again, that's not a supporting piece. That is a piece that stands alone and is like, this is a song you listen to and it gives you this. It's not there to help. It's there. That is its own thing. It is its own song.
And it's
like,
cool.
It's cool, yeah, but it's like a song that you hear on a radio versus the score that you'll hear in a movie.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Awesome, man. Great question. And thank you all for coming out and staying late. And this was a lot of fun. I'd love to sign that one guy's thing that I promised I'd sign, but then I really need to go to the bathroom, and I'm really sorry. But Carrie and I are doing a signing later tomorrow, and then we got other panels. And I fucking love you guys. And thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming.